to the end. Doesn't matter what the world means against me. I will fight to the end. Doesn't matter what people say. I will love to the end.
Good afternoon and welcome to Cut to the Chase with Senator Chase. This is our weekly call-in town hall and radio show. I'm State Senator Amanda Chase, your weekly radio host, and I represent you in the General Assembly. I represent most of Chesterfield, all of Colonial Heights, and all of Amelia. And guess what? I have an office, and that office, it's the state capitol in downtown Richmond, not to be confused with D.C. I know we have a lot of federal issues, but thankfully, I don't directly affect the federal legislation. So I'm very thankful that my office is at the state capitol. But we are currently on a break between regular session, which means annually from January until about March, and we're preparing for special session, which the governor has just called, to address the state budget on Wednesday, April the 11th, and then we'll go back in for reconvene on the 18th. So I'm not allowed to schedule or go on any vacations until after June. Until we get this budget taken care of, there's about a $3 billion difference. So little bit of work ahead of us right there. But I am here today to answer your questions and to keep you informed. This is a town hall about what you need to know. And as it pertains to state issues is what I try to focus on. I'm going to give you a little bit of an overview. And the number, by the way, is 804-454-1366. 804-454-1366. And you can give us a call. And let me tell you a couple things that I wanted to talk about today. I have invited Delegate Mark Levine to come on the show today, and we co-founded the Transparency Caucus together. I'm going to tell you a little bit more about him. He's going to be joining me in just a few minutes. But, you know, there is some good news. You know, the culture in Richmond is changing to a more open, transparent government. People tell me all the time, and this is honestly why part of why I ran for office, because politicians, they don't seem like they can work together. And God help them if they can actually get something done, right? Certainly, Delegate Levine and I have defied the odds and hope to change the culture in Richmond. And we had a few successes over the last couple of years. We were both elected back in 2015, and we met at a breakfast for the freshman class that our now governor, then Lieutenant Governor Ralph Northam, was hosting. And we didn't know anybody in the room. We didn't know Republicans, Democrats, Independents. We were just all in a room together, and we just happened to be standing next to each other and just started talking. And we started talking about having a more transparent government that was accessible to the people. And we just really just kind of sparked an interest. And a long story short, from that breakfast, we co-founded back in 2016 something called the Transparency Caucus. And Delegate Levine is a liberal Democrat. I'm a conservative Republican. And we've actually focused on what we do agree on and have actually been pretty successful at bringing about change in both of our respective parties. And so we're going to talk a little bit about that today. We're also going to talk about the Second Amendment. And in light of recent mass shootings, you know, what are legislators in Richmond proposing to do to address guns in general, protecting our children in schools, movie theaters, churches? You know, I've get some interesting text from even some of my girlfriends who are conservatives, who are, you know, obviously concerned about their kids who are in schools with all these school shootings. I mean, I still have kids in school. How do I feel as a mom? Well, I'm going to share that with you, and you'll get to hear Delegate Levine's perspective, my perspective. We have very different views on guns, but we're going to attempt to talk about it in a civil way today. We're going to try this and hopefully be good examples for all of us, right? And the last subject that we're going to talk about is domestic abuse and violence. You know, I have seen an increase in reports to my office this month. I was in court today with a victim, and it's a very emotional subject. It's actually very emotional to Delegate Levine as well. And he has a personal story that that he will share. What do you do if you or a loved one is a victim? You know, a lot of people keep silent and they suffer in fear. I want to talk to you about some resources that are available to you. You know, you don't need to suffer in silence. We're going to talk to you about some things that are available to you. So Before we get going too far into the into this town hall, I really do want to thank WNTW, our friends here at 820 AM and 97.7 FN, because they allow me to provide this free public service to you each week. They don't pay me to do this show. I do it because I feel like I should be accountable to you. I need to be accessible and transparent, and they've allowed me to do that. So I really want to thank my friends here. If you want to try to reach me later, if you have a question, concern, you want me to address something on the show, you can contact my contact information is on my website. It's chaseforsenate.com. Again, if you have a question about today's topic, I'm going to give you the number again. It's 804-454-1366. All right, here we go. We're going to get started here. And let's see if we have Delegate Levine. Is he actually on the line?
Okay. I am.
Delegate Levine, how are you?
I'm good. How are you, Senator Chase?
It is.
It's rare to hear you call me Delegate Levine, and we usually just call each other offended, Mark.
I know, it's great. But when people are listening in, I want them to know that they are talking to Delegate Levine here. And I have your biography here. I just thought, you know, it's interesting. We interact with each other quite a bit in the General Assembly, but when I sit there and I do the biographies on the guests that come on my show, it is just... It's amazing, and I've enjoyed reading over your biography. And first of all, why don't you start off by telling folks what you do for a living?
Well, sure. I'm a talk radio host. In fact, you and I may be the only talk radio hosts in the General Assembly. I was a trial lawyer for some years, and I was a lawyer in Congress for a few years. And then I started doing my own local radio show that now is syndicated across the country. We're in about 40 markets. In Virginia, we're in Charlottesville. I used to be in the Northern Virginia area in a very large station, but then I got elected as delegate and they kicked me off the air, which I didn't appreciate very much. So you're lucky to have your station appreciate elected officials. They told me, well, elected officials don't need to be on the air. And I obviously disagree. I think we're more accessible that way. So, but I am on the air across the country and in Virginia and Charlottesville. And, I also go on TV and serve as a pundit on various stations. Many conservatives see me on Fox News. I'm one of their token liberals. I'm proud to be there.
You can go on YouTube and see that.
That's true. You can see me giving them heck. Absolutely.
I love it. So the name of your show is Inside Scoop.
Right. And my radio website is the thing for my delegate website is marklevinetalk.com, MarkLevineTalk. TALK.com. Some people confuse me with conservative radio host Mark Levin. His name doesn't have an E at the end. He's L-E-V-I-N. So I don't want anyone to confuse me with him. I don't think like him, talk like him, look like him. We have very divergent political views. Sometimes I joke that the second E stands for empathy, which I think I have a bit more of than Mark Levin, but at least people should understand I'm definitely not him.
You know what's so funny? I'm having flashbacks to that first breakfast when we met at the lieutenant governor's, that was his office. I mean, where
his
he had
office.
The breakfast
yeah.
and everything. Mm-hmm. But I thought you were that delegate Mark Levine. And I was like, oh, that's delegate Mark Levine. I'm going to go talk to him. He's a fellow conservative. Yeah. Right?
He's Mark Levin. He pronounces it Levin, and I pronounce it Levine. It's a subtle difference.
On a name tag, but, it looks the same. Trust me. Well, I have really enjoyed getting to know you, and I had no idea that you were a Fulbright scholar and that you graduated from Harvard University and Yale Law School.
Yeah, I don't talk about those things too much. I feel like that won't help me get my bills passed, so I try to keep quiet about things like that.
That's funny.
But I've enjoyed knowing you as well. And for those of you who don't know, I mean, Amanda and I, we really have a genuine friendship. You know, a lot of people say, you know, my friend on the other side of the aisle, and you wonder if people really are friends. But Amanda and I generally like each other. And I think that's actually a good thing, because I think too many Americans are in their silos and only talking with people who agree with them. And I think that's really dangerous for our country. I mean, we're Americans first. We disagree on gun views or whatever the issue is. But we all love our country. We all serve because we want to help our country. And I'm just really afraid that, particularly in 2018, that we're more divided than I can remember in my lifetime. So I'm really hopeful that that people are friends with people who disagree with them. Frankly, it's a lot more interesting chatting with someone who disagrees with you than someone who agrees with you. I mean, you could get some really good discussions. Otherwise, it's just, yeah, I agree. So on my radio show, I'm constantly bringing conservatives on the air, and I'm going to bring Amanda Chase, Senator Chase, onto my my show when I restart in April. And
looking forward to that. I better not get hate mail from your listeners. They're going to be like, oh, my gracious.
You won't, but listen, I may get some from your listeners. But
it's all good. So we have 30 seconds. We're going to go to a break real quick, but stay tuned, you all. We're going to have a really good time today on the air. We are going to talk about a number of issues. You're going to hear both of our perspectives, and we're going to have fun. So stay tuned. We'll be right back. Senator Chase and Delegate Mark Levine, we'll be right back. Welcome back to Cut to the Chase with Senator Chase. This is our town hall and radio show, and I'm glad to be back. You know, General Assembly is pretty brutal, and it's nice to be back. Of course, I stayed on the radio even during the brutal session, but Delegate Mark Levine is on the line today. And for those of you who didn't catch us in the beginning, I'm a conservative, he's a liberal, I'm a Republican, he's a Democrat. But, you know, we found some common ground with this Transparency Caucus. And so we wanted to talk to you a little bit about that today. And we actually had a lot of success, Mark. Why don't you talk a little bit about the letter that we drafted, and we had other legislators to sign on board. I mean, we didn't even have a bill. I'm going to let you take
the
lead.
I'm proud of our efforts because actually, one of our members, you'll recall, tried to do it through legislation. Basically, the problem was that when Amanda and I, excuse me, Senator Chase and I, I'm not used to that.
You call me Amanda.
You can call me Mark. It's much, much better. But when Amanda and I came in as freshmen, they really didn't record much of what happened. In fact, at the time we came in, on the floor, they didn't even record what happened on the floor of the House of Delegates, or I don't think even the Senate. They streamed it, but they didn't record it. So if you wanted to know what happened, you know, 2 days ago in the General Assembly, you were out of luck. And the other thing was that most bills, the majority of bills, they really, they're created in committee, they're amended in committee, a majority of them die in committee or in the House in subcommittees. And honestly, once most things get on the floor, I would say 95% of the time, if a bill gets to the floor, it passes the floor. We give a bunch of speeches, we introduce a bunch of people, but the real action, the creation of the bills, the real argument and debate goes on in committee. And while committees were always open to the public, anyone could come down to Richmond, usually on about one day's notice, and come in at 7 a.m., you know. But for my constituent, I mean, you live pretty close to Richmond, you know, Amanda. I live in Alexandria, and my constituents would have had to make a two-hour drive on, you know, a day's notice on a work day when most are working or taking care of their kids or whatever it is, and they just couldn't get down there. And so you had to just sort of tell people what happened, and they wanted to see what happened. They wanted to know why a bill passed or why a bill failed or what was the reasoning or who voted which way. And they didn't even record votes. A lot of people would cast votes and it would be a voice vote. So Amanda and I, again, we disagree on many issues.
Almost everything else.
Almost everything else. We'll get to some of those disagreements later on the broadcast. But we both agree that our constituents and everyone in Virginia has a right to see what we're doing. So when a bill to do it through the front door failed, I decided to do what, frankly, I'd done in Congress when I used to work as a legislative assistant in Congress as a lawyer there, and simply circulate a letter, because I didn't think that most delegates and senators would be willing to not sign a letter that wanted transparency. So Amanda circulated in the Senate. I circulated in the House. She focused on Republicans. I focused on Democrats. And we circulated a letter that said that we wanted all hearings, all committee and subcommittee hearings, recorded, filmed, streamed, archived, and we wanted all votes recorded in committee and subcommittee, because we felt that people had a right to know how we vote and how we debate on bills. And to our wonderful, happy surprise, some 85 out of 140 delegates and senators, or more than 60%, a majority in both chambers, supported this bill. It was bipartisan. It wasn't a bill. Supported this letter. It was a letter to the clerks of the House and the Senate. And we circulated it, submitted it on the last day. And then this year, they took us up on most of what we asked for. And this year, for the first year ever, they now film and archive every committee meeting in the House and the Senate, and they record every vote, whether it's in committee or in subcommittee. There's one thing they still don't do. They still don't film subcommittees. So we got a little bit ways to go, but still, it's a real sea change. And I found it really useful just if I want to see how my bill went in a Senate committee or an interesting thing happened, you know, I wasn't in the committee. A lot of legislators use it, too, to see, oh, that's why the bill died. Well, maybe I need to revise this bill. It's really a very useful resource, not just for the public, but for us as well.
And I know, I don't know about you. I was looking over your committee assignments. I sit on four committees and two subcommittees, and many times I have several committees that are meeting at the same time, and so I have to proxy. In the Senate, we have proxies. I don't think you all have the proxies.
No, we don't.
And a lot of people don't realize the House rules are completely different than the Senate rules. We operate on totally different schedules. We look at totally different bills until after crossover. It's not till we look at each other's bills. And so it's important to be able to have these archived committee meetings so that we can go back and, for one, follow our own bill so that we can see how things are progressing. And this year, I think I had more bills than I ever have filed ever, and I don't know that I would ever do that again to myself or anyone else. But you know, you're trying to keep up with a lot of different plates, and to be able to go to the video on the website and actually replay that. And I joke around. I mean, if you go to local governments committee, did you ever have any bills in local government, Mark?
Counties, cities, and towns is what we call it.
Okay, but did you come before Senator Stanley's committee? He is a comedian, a complete comedian. And I have vowed to go back out of session and just watch local government committees just so that I can. Senator Stanley is a trip, and he's been on the show before, too. But you have to pull your popcorn out for the local governments committee. It's pretty entertaining. But
it's also just really nice for constituents. I mean, even your constituents, even though you're close to Richmond, you know, sometimes you have to wait hours for your bill to be heard. This way you can go and you care about HB 1003. You just look up HB 1003, find the committee it was in, and you can look it up. And what I do is every bill I introduce, I post the hearing on my website so people can look and say, oh, I'm interested in that bill, and immediately watch what happened. And see, you know, if the bill died, why it died, if it passed, why it passed. And I just think that's something that all legislators should do. Frankly, I wish members of Congress would do it, too. You know, we'll have to spread the word, Amanda.
Yeah, we'll try to keep doing that. Now, for now, and I've mentioned this on our show, they can go to virginiagenerassembly.gov for anything, whether it's bills, topics, streaming of regular session, committee meetings, whatever that's the go-to place, virginiagenerassembly.gov. And our future goals, as we mentioned, is to video those subcommittee meetings. And then also we were talking about promotion of transparency legislation for the upcoming session, because we have different bills that pertain to FOIA and just different bills about protecting different branches of government.
Like the Freedom of Information Act. Those of us in the know call it FOIA, but it's the way people can get documents from your state government or sometimes from local government to find out what your government's doing. And to me, it's just in a free and transparent society, that is a citizen's right. And it's what we want to promote.
So let's go back to a discussion that you and I had when we, at the end of a transparency meeting, we were just sitting there talking. We were like, do we dare talk about something that we don't agree on? Like the whole gun issue, you know, the school shootings were happening like all the time. And, you know, I still have kids in school, and, you know, I'm a mom first before I'm a legislator or anything else. I am a mom, and I'm concerned for the safety of my kids. And you and I just started talking about, we had like a 1 or 2 hour conversation just on the gun issue. And we finished, you're like, man, we should talk about this on the radio.
We really should, because I think that particularly on gun issues, I think that a lot of people have closed minds, and I'm referring to just left and right. I'm not picking on one side. And it's important that we see where we can come together. Many of you probably know the March for Our Lives in Washington, D.C. is tomorrow. I'll be going. I'll be speaking. And some people are predicting up to 500,000 people will show up. I don't know. I'll find out. But I'll be there on the National Mall tomorrow, at the mall led by the Parkland students. And I like to think there is some reasonable middle ground. At least I like to hope so. But I have to tell you, Amanda, in the General Assembly, I haven't found much opportunities for middle ground from Republicans. And it's not just me. We've had our leader, David Toscano. We had Ken Plum, the longest serving member of the House of Delegates. Just to be honest with you, we Democrats proposed 70 bills dealing with guns, and 69 failed. The only one that passed is that we're going to allow a license plate that says stop gun violence. And even that one was controversial.
Yeah,
so
I saw
we just
that
haven't
one.
Had a good success rate. And I don't know if we're doing something, if you think we're doing something wrong, but these are bills on things like background checks and banning bump stocks.
We're going to talk about that when we come back from the break. We're going to be right back with Delegate Mark Levine right after the break. Thanks. Thanks for tuning in to Cut to the Chase with Senator Chase. This is our weekly town hall and radio show. And joining me today is Delegate Mark Levine. And so good to have him here today, even though he's a progressive liberal Democrat and I'm a conservative Republican. This is going to be fun because now we're going to talk. We've just talked about something that we're passionate about, radio, transparency. And whenever we had that discussion in my office, I said, Mark, just help me understand where you're coming from, because you're a very passionate advocate for women, children, particularly those who are survivors of domestic violence and sexual assault. And you shared with me about your sister and just how painful that was. And I appreciate you sharing that with me. And I had no idea and I didn't know what to say, to be honest.
I actually think it's important that people talk about this. I think it's important, frankly, as a matter of policy, that people talk about it, because there's a big stigma attached to domestic violence and people don't talk about it. And I really think that silence leads to danger. I started talking about it. This happened my sister 20 years ago, August 15th, 1996, was murdered by her husband. They'd been having difficulties in their marriage. She had two small children at the time, age 6 and 2. She was 33 when she died. And it shocked all of us. Obviously, it rocked our world. She's my only sister. I lost someone I was very, very close with. And then it actually, believe it or not, got worse. I know it's hard to believe that anything could be worse than someone murdering your sister. But then her husband, the father of the kids, took the two kids, ran to Mexico. They're not Mexican. There's no ties there. They just ran away from the law. And it took us 10 years to get the kids back and to get him justice. Now, I'll fast forward to the end, because there is a, if not a happy ending, at least a satisfying ending. My former brother-in-law is now serving a 56-year sentence in a Tennessee penitentiary. The kids were brought back to be raised by my parents, their grandparents. And they're actually doing really well now after, years of scars. It's very hard for them. But, this issue touches me very personally. And it's why I'm on the advisory committee on domestic violence and sexual violence in Richmond. I've had several bills dealing with sexual violence, domestic violence. One of the things I'm really proud of that we're able to do in Northern Virginia is we have a 24/7 center for anyone who's sexually assaulted to go to. We just opened it. I mean, it's one of the things I did as a delegate. It didn't exist before I became a delegate. We applied for some federal funds. And basically, there are these sexual assault nurse examiners that are trained to deal with a really, when someone's been raped, there's a lot of things to deal with. One, there's, obviously the emotional pain of that. And someone has to be very caring to give, the immediate therapy that's necessary, while getting forensic evidence that we want to get to, frankly, catch the perpetrator. Some 90% of sexual assaults are done by someone who's done it before. So if we catch these bad guys early, then we can, frankly, prevent 90%, up to 90% of rapes. And so you want really a trained professional. And now we have these trained professionals available 24/7 in Northern Virginia. I'm really proud of that work. But the point is that, one of the reasons I ran for office, frankly, was taking a personal pain of mine and wanting to make a difference, wanting to help others. And frankly, one of the reasons I do talk about it is I don't think there should be a stigma attached. You know, the stigma should go to the bad guy. The stigma
That's
should
right.
go to the rapist. They have every reason to be ashamed. But victims should never be ashamed. It is not your fault if you're a victim of domestic violence. It's not your fault if you're a victim of rape. And so many people somehow feel it's their fault. I mean, my sister, frankly, was embarrassed that she married a guy who ended up abusing her. And people have to get past that embarrassment because it's not the victim's fault. So many times when someone is sexually assaulted, they say, well, why was she wearing that low-cut dress? Or why was she at the bar at 2 a.m.? Which are really, I think, are unfair questions. You know, no one deserves violence. And women have a right to drink at a bar just like men do and to go out at 2 a.m. just like men do. And we've got to stop this victim shaming. And that's one of the reasons why I do talk about what happened to my sister. And I really encourage other people to speak out so they know if this is happening to you, and it's not just women, there are men that are abused domestic violence. It's mostly women. But the point is, if you're being abused, you should speak out. There are resources. There are shelters. There are, there are toll-free numbers that's not your fault. And that's a message that I really try to convey whenever I talk about this issue.
Well, and it's so timely. I was actually in court today with a victim and helping them to go through the process and just, you know, how painful it is. And, you know, it is so personal because it has to do with someone that's in your family that's hurting you, and you want to have that reconciled relationship, and you need to know when, at what point you need to seek safety for your family. And so we're going to be talking a little bit more. We have the James House, which is here in our area. We've got some other resources, which we're going to talk about later. But I do want to give out the number here just for those who are in our listening area. It's the number here. It's to the James House. It's 804-458-2704. And if you don't remember that, you can just call my office. And I've had a number of victims to call my office this week. And that's when I reached out to you because of our story that, you know, we had talked about earlier. And, you know, so
I want to encourage people to call. Look, you may wonder if you're in an abusive relationship. You're not sure. These calls are confidential. All of these hotlines are confidential. And it's a way just to have someone to talk to. You may not want to talk to your family member or your friend. But please call this number if you think you might need it.
All right. We'll be right back with Delegate Levine, and then we're going to talk about the Second Amendment. So stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Lately, I've been losing sleep, dreaming about the things that we could be. But baby, I've been praying hard, said no more counting dollars, we'll be counting stars. Yeah, we'll be counting stars.
So Delegate Levine and I are talking today about the victims. Domestic abuse and violence, and unfortunately, sometimes that does involve a gun. And as we've seen in the Sunday's church shooting in Sutherland Springs, Texas, as we've seen in Maryland, just the tragedy of so many innocent lives, children being killed, church members. You know, there's a sense in all of us, if you're a normal human being, you have compassion for these folks, and you think, naturally, you know, what if that were my school? I mean, what would happen if that happened right here in Chesterfield County, and how would I deal with that? And my understanding is that we did have an issue at Huguenot High School. It was a hoax, but nonetheless, you know, parents are on edge, and so are the students. I mean, my boys come home and they talk about it, and you know, so I think it is important to have these discussions. You know, I look at things. You know, I want to have compassion, but I think it's important for us to have compassion. It's also important to realize the Second Amendment, what it says. And I thought I would just read to you basically the Second Amendment. It says a well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. And, you know, you have to look back in the time. whenever the overriding purpose of the framers in guaranteeing the right of the people to keep and bear arms was a check on the standing army, which the Constitution gave the Congress the power to raise and support. And when they were talking about a well-regulated militia, back when our Constitution was written, it meant that every able-bodied and armed man who was not in the army, whose help could be requested in a time of danger. And so as Noah Webster put in a pamphlet urging ratification of the Constitution, he said, before a standing army can rule, the people must be disarmed as they are in almost every kingdom in Europe. And I think what they're warning us is they're saying that America is very different than other countries. They want to make sure that the everyday average citizen has the ability to protect and defend not only themselves, but to rise up as a militia if they get into a government that becomes tyrannical. And so, you know, at what point do you restrict those rights? Do you put those gun control issues, which, you know, I know you and I are going to probably disagree on this one, but, you know, I have always looked at it not just from a personal standpoint, but as a nation. At what point would you restrict a person's ability to be able to defend themselves and also to rise up and to defend our country against an intruder? And so I look at it from that, and I know, tell me what your thoughts are on, I know we've talked about different gun legislation. I think you even had one in that we both agreed on that you said, I think it was House Bill 1001, where you said that terrorists should not get guns. And I completely agree with that.
And I'll get to that in a second. First, I do want to say that I largely agree with your historical analysis, which is nice. It's nice when we can agree on facts and then disagree on opinion. I do agree that the Second Amendment was used largely to fight the British and to fight Native Americans. Frankly, that's a whole nother issue. But the idea was we were on the frontier, and ordinary people had to come together with their muskets and defend against, attacks by Native Americans. I would argue the liberals, some of those were justified. But moving on, I don't want to go there right now. But also to defend against the British. I mean, we just came through Lexington and Concord, right? They were trying to get the arms storehouses. Mm-hmm. That's all part of the revolution. The Second Amendment made a lot of sense for its time. And a lot of people are surprised to find that out, given that since World War II, we've had, you know, a constant standing Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines, Coast Guard. But that actually has to be re-upped every 2 years because Congress is forbidden by the Constitution to just say an army exists forever. So 1776 and 1791, I question, Amanda, whether it makes sense today because we do have a standing army. Sorry, founders, but we do, and we've had one for a long period of time now. And I don't think anyone's guns, I don't care whether they're AR-15s or even machine guns, are going to be able to fight the U.S. Army. I think any person or group of people that want to fight the U.S. military, whether foreign or domestic, they're going to lose. I mean, they have planes, they have nuclear weapons. I think it's archaic to think that the people are going to rise up against their government right here, right now in the United States of America. I think the way to fight a tyrannical government in the United States of America is to use our Constitution to vote the bums out of office, to do impeachment if we have to use criminal law. We do have ways to fight an oppressive government, and they're laid out in the Constitution. We don't live on the frontier anymore, and I don't see, you know, attacks across the border. I think that the original purpose of the Second Amendment, which was a legitimate purpose, just doesn't exist 200 years later.
So let me ask you this. I know that we see these terrorist strikes. I mean, they happen all the time. And there are people that are converting online, to these terrorist organizations. They go by many, many different names, which I won't go into. So, you know, we don't know what we don't know. And, I just think that it's always a good idea, you know, as George Mason remarked to his Virginia delegates regarding the colonies' experience with Britain, they said the monarch's goal has been to disarm the people and that was the best and most effectual way to enslave them. And so as a Second Amendment defender, my biggest concern is that if, you know, if you look at a government, is their goal? What is their goal? Are they going to try to disarm the people so that they can enslave them like they do in some other countries? And so, you know, I think that's always a possibility that we have to be careful of. And so, you know, when I hear the arguments about banning the bump stock, whenever you're going to ban the AR-15s or whatever, I think, yeah, I might want to have those in my possession because you don't know what you're going to be faced against 5 years from now, 10 years from now, 15 years from now. I mean, let's say the power grid goes down and, you know, we don't have all the technology that we have. I mean, we could be back on a frontier in a matter of weeks, honestly, except we wouldn't know how to plant food, would we? Because there's no grocery stores anymore. But we have,
I mean,
generations of people who don't even know how to, you know, grow food anymore. So
I'm sure there are people who have shelters in their backyard that are stocked up with a year of canned goods, a survivalist. But I think that we have 33,000 people who die every year at the hands of a gun. Two-thirds of those are suicide, it's true. Of the remaining one-third, 10,000 or so, half are accidents and half are murder. And that's a tremendous number of people that are dying every single year. In this one-hour conversation, four Americans will be shot dead. It's on average four an hour in the United States. It's almost 100 a day. And this is a real problem. It's a real present existing problem. This idea of this survivalist that we're going to have. I mean, look, and I'm actually okay with people having guns to defend themselves. That's not my issue. My issue is I don't want bad people to have guns. People like terrorists, right. People like gang members, people like perpetrators of domestic violence. So we're going to have a longer discussion another day, Amanda, on air, hopefully, about where we draw the lines. But just in general, if you're worried about an oppressive government, I mean, you know, we have a right to impeach our president. We have, but we're not going to take down the U.S. military. I mean, the U.S. military is controlled by a civilian that we elect. And so the other thing to remember is that of all the world's guns, we're like 4% of the world's population. We have 43% of the world's guns. You know, we are more guns than any other nation on earth, more than Somalia, more than Yemen, more than complete anarchic societies where people really are living in a survivalist mentality. I'm just not that worried about that. I'm much more worried about some insane person entering a movie theater thinking he's Batman and shooting a bunch of people. That's happening every day, whereas to me, these are kind of far-fetched notions. And honestly, even if we had a bad government, today I don't think your weapon, your gun, is going to stop a tank. I just think this hypothetical notion is stopping us from doing some real actions to save real lives in Virginia.
Well, I think it's very interesting because we also have to take into account the number of guns that lives actually save. Because a lot of times when we look at the statistics, we look at the number of people that have been killed. But we don't always have, and I don't know that we'll ever have the numbers that show how many lives guns actually saved simply by, you know, having the gun on your possession and deterring crime. And I know as a female that's out, you know, I'm going to all these events, that type of thing. If someone sees a gun visibly, they're not going to mess with me as much as if they just think I'm an innocent female walking. I mean, if they, you know, they're less likely to approach me if they think that I am able to defend myself. And we're going to come back. We've already gone to a break. So stay tuned. We'll be back with Delegate Mark Levine. It's hard to believe it's already the last segment of Cut to the Chase with Senator Chase. And I really enjoyed having Delegate Levine on today, and I hope to have you back again. We have a lot more to talk about. I want to close with giving a shout out to Deputy Blaine Gaskill, if I can get his name right here. He rushed toward the sound of gunshots in the Maryland High School shooting, putting himself not only in the line of fire, but also at the center of the white hot national debate on school safety. And it's interesting, his name, Gaskill. He's a 34-year-old SWAT-trained officer of the St. Mary's County Sheriff's Office, and he was working as the school's resource officer when a student opened fire in the first floor hallway, striking a female student and possibly a male classmate. He's the one that confronted the shooter and saved the lives. And he was not injured. And, you know, that was the Maryland shooter. And you know what I find frustrating is that you don't hear much talk about Deputy Blaine Gaskill. And I think we should talk more about the heroes than we do of the names of the shooters, because everybody seems to know the names of the shooters. Can we agree on that?
Absolutely. I actually never mention the shooters' names. I talk about the victims.
That's
and
right.
I talk about the heroes, whether including the heroes who do things like who are unarmed and stand in the way. Obviously, Deputy Gaskill is a hero. I'd like to focus, and we're running out of time here, so we'll have to do this another hour, but where we can agree, and I hope that, Amanda, you and I can agree that bad guys shouldn't have easy access to guns. That, you know, I'm fine with school resource officers having guns, but I don't want terrorists or gang members or people who commit domestic violence from owning guns, and that's why I support universal background checks. And that doesn't take away ordinary law-abiding people's Second Amendment rights. It just takes away the right, the gun possessions of those who have already given up their rights by violating the law.
You know, and it's interesting you were to say that. I have spent all week studying Virginia's gun laws, and fascinating how many of those issues are actually already in our gun laws. Even just an application by the Virginia State Police ask you tons and tons of different questions about your mental health. You just you have to demonstrate handgun competency. Have you been convicted?
To join the police, you can buy a gun in the street with no background check or forms whatsoever, and that's my issue.
Yeah, and you know, I think as long as we're selling guns, I mean, I know in my neighborhood we had bad guys coming in and stealing the guns from law-abiding citizens. They would hide them in the backyard. They'd dig a hole. They'd skip school. It's insane what was happening. They were stealing guns from the good guys. I don't think we are ever going to prevent the bad guys from taking and getting the guns. What we need to make sure, in my opinion, that we need to do is to make sure that good guys have easy access to guns so that they can protect themselves and their families. So I can't believe already, Tom. I really, Delegate Levine, thank you so much for joining us today. It's a pleasure to have you on, and we're going to have you back on. And I'm looking forward to being on your show as well.
Absolutely, Senator Chase. I will bring you on. We will continue discussion on both our stations, and let this be the beginning of many long discussions to follow.
Fantastic. Thanks so much. And thank you again for joining us today on Cut to the Chase with Senator Chase on WNTW The Answer. And I hope you will join us again next Friday from 6 to 7 p.m. as we strive to address issues that are important to you. And once again, if you live in Chesterfield, Colonial Heights, or Amelia, I'm your state senator, and I will do whatever I can to help you if you have a situation pertaining to domestic violence or anything we've talked about today. You feel free to call my office if you can't remember these numbers. I'm happy to direct you to the right source. If you would like notices of upcoming events, town halls, or my weekly newsletter, you can also visit my website at chaseforsenate.com. During session, and including the reconvened session, I actually send out a weekly update if you're a subscriber each Friday. And then out of session, we send out a monthly newsletter. But of course, you can always catch me every Friday from 6 to 7 p.m. here on 820 a.m. and 97.7 FM. Until next week.